this right here is a full frame camera capable of raw video. In fact, it's the only mirrorless full frame camera that can do raw video. Yes, the 1DX Mark III that's soon coming out, a DSLR can do raw internally. You guys probably saw Peter's footage of that and it looks insane, but that camera is also very, very expensive. And what is this camera? It's a Nikon of all things. Nikon is giving us the first full frame raw video camera. But before we really start using this camera, first we need to do some tests, A, to see what the workflow is like, because raw can be a little bit tricky, and then B, we need to see the quality. Is the quality insane? Okay, those were our first test clips with the Nikon C6, the raw video. Oh, it is really cold today. -11, -12 degrees Celsius, I think that's like 12 Fahrenheit. 12 Fahrenheit. All right, so you can't record the RAW internally. You do need something like this, the Atomos Ninja 5, in order to record that RAW video. But luckily for us, the whole package, actually they sell the Z6 Filmmakers Kit, which comes with the Z6 camera, comes with the Ninja 5 recorder, comes with a gimbal, a microphone. It comes with so much different stuff. That whole package cost $3,800, which is still a lot of money, but that's essentially everything that you would need to start making videos at a really high quality level. Now you can buy just the recorder and the camera for around $3,000, so still a lot of money, but that's a lot less than something like the 1DX Mark III, which is the only other mirrorless or DSLR full frame camera that can record raw video right now. That camera is gonna cost $6,500. So that's a lot more money. That's a lot of money. Or you could just go all the way up to, you know, a cinema camera, full frame cinema camera that can shoot raw video, get the C500 Mark II and spend $16,000 on a camera. That's a lot of money. Yes, you could get the Blackmagic 6K camera and have raw video in 6K, but it's not full frame. Okay, so let's talk about the workflow. To set this thing up, it's actually really, really simple. You just plug it in, and then all you gotta do is find HDMI in the Z6 menus, enable the raw output, then go to the Ninja and make sure you're recording in the ProRes RAW codec. And this is actually my very first time using ProRes RAW since hearing about it like 2 years ago. And right away, I was super pumped because I love ProRes. ProRes is such a good codec. And then to have some of those RAW capabilities in ProRes, that just seems like the perfect combination. But as always with RAW, the file sizes are still pretty dang big. And we tested it out for a minute of footage. It's gonna be 3.8 gigabytes of footage. Yikes, that's a lot of data. Even though it's ProRes RAW, it's still very, very data heavy. The other hiccup for a lot of people is that right now still, you can only use ProRes RAW inside of Apple's Final Cut Pro 10. So for some people, that's gonna be a really big downer, especially if you're a Premiere user or if you just use a PC, well then you're not really gonna be able to use this ProRes RAW. I'm sure eventually, soon enough, I thought it was already gonna happen, Premiere and DaVinci and all these other programs are also gonna be able to support ProRes RAW, but right now they can't. And that is the only way to get the raw footage out of the Z6 is by using ProRes RAW. Also, the Z6 was already able to do 10-bit N-Log onto the Ninja 5 recorder, but there was a bit of a crop. And now with the ProRes RAW, there's only like the very smallest bit of crop. So like basically none, you won't notice it, but it looked like there was a tiny bit of a crop when we were comparing it to the footage straight in camera. So you've recorded your raw footage and then you need to bring it into Final Cut Pro. There's a few things that you need to know when you're working with ProRes RAW so that you come out with the best results. The first thing is you need to make sure your library is in the wide gamut HDR. And then make sure the color space for your event is actually Rec 709. And this is because most monitors, most people are gonna be watching it on normal non-HDR monitors. So if you left it on one of the HDR modes, you're gonna be exporting an HDR file. And then when somebody on a non-HDR screen looks at it, it's gonna look a little bit wonky. Or when you put it on YouTube, I've heard that YouTube actually tries to spit out some sort of Rec 709 version to you. So you're kind of leaving it in YouTube's hands to kind of color grade your footage a little bit. So I don't recommend that. Leave it in Rec 709. Rec 709 is kind of just like your normal saturation and contrast, like you normally see on TV. We're just all used to it. Now you see this footage in here. This is not how we filmed it. This is like insanely overexposed looking. It looks absolutely horrendous, but don't freak out just yet. All you need to do is just bring down the exposure. I don't know why it comes in like this into Final Cut Pro. I feel like they could make this part of the workflow a little bit better, but with some small tweaks with the exposure, the footage looks incredible. In fact, it's actually really easy to color correct. You really only need to do these exposure changes, and you don't really need to change the colors because they look so, so great straight out of camera. So those are kind of the extra steps in the workflow when you're working with RAW video and ProRes RAW. They're a little bit annoying, but nothing crazy. I think for the newbies, this can seem a little bit scary and that can freak you out. But for anybody that's kind of used to the video world, there's nothing crazy here. But the more important question here is the quality. Is it insanely high quality? Well, yeah, it's pretty dang good. I was pleasantly surprised at how beautiful the image is coming straight out of the camera with nothing except for those exposure changes. The colors look incredible. The detail is there. There isn't really any more dynamic range, I wouldn't say, but the image in itself looks really, really good. And when you're comparing it to the flat color profile in the Z6, it's a lot better than that. And surprisingly, when you compare it to the 10-bit N-Log, which is also being recorded onto the Ninja 5, it's like 100 times better. I'm really, really impressed. There is a massive difference. I was honestly expecting like a tiny bit of a difference in look, but I think the colors is the thing I'm most excited about with the Z6 and the RAW video, just because it was so accurate to what we filmed here. You really didn't need to do any color correcting, just those exposure changes. So with RAW video, again, you're not getting really any more dynamic range, but you are giving yourself a lot more room to make some mistakes and correct them in post and to go crazier with the color grade. It's gonna stand up a lot better when you're color grading, especially when you're choosing like a specific color, for example, the skin tones, and you wanna change those. The footage isn't gonna fall apart right away, so you can really go crazy with your color grades and still keep all of that amazing quality. I'm actually very, very impressed at how good the image looks, especially coming out of, I think this camera is about $1,800 right now, and then the recorder is about $800 or $900. So for sub $3,000, you're getting this insanely beautiful image straight out of camera, and then you have a really good starting point to make some really high quality videos. And that really changes who I would recommend the Z6 to, because now you have this extra feature of this really high quality image. So for short films or for, you know, really cool music videos, for those times when you need all of the quality that you can possibly get, or, you know, you're making a showreel and you really want to show off, I'd say the Z6 just got a massive upgrade. It went from like a pretty interesting camera, it's definitely good, to one of a kind. It is unique in that it is the only full frame camera right now that can record RAW video. Yes, you do need the external recorder, but it is the only one until the 1DX Mark III comes out. But again, price difference, like big difference. I also wanted to check what it looks like if we underexpose a lot because of this whole weird exposure thing. But we noticed really quickly that as you bring up the shadows, they don't hold the detail as well. So you do want to kind of expose normally, kind of protecting the highlights. But really in the end, you have a little bit more room to make some mistakes. It doesn't have to be as perfect, and you can fix the color grade or your color correction in post. So to quickly recap, I would say the workflow, it's not perfect. Massive file sizes, you can only use Final Cut Pro 10 right now, which can be a really big downside for a lot of people. The initial import of the footage and it being super overexposed can be a little bit annoying, but actually I find that the color correcting is really, really quick, because all you really need to do is that exposure change and you don't need to really mess around with the colors. And the colors is a lot harder for most people to work with. And then of course, having to use an external recorder, so that makes this whole camera a lot bigger, almost twice as big, so that is a downside. But you are getting some of the most high quality footage that I've ever seen out of a mirrorless or DSLR camera. Oh, and you can only record up to 30 frames per second. So unlike the 1DX Mark III, which has 60 frames per second internally, very impressive. This one, you're not gonna be able to do any slow motion. But overall, I gotta say, I'm honestly impressed. This was a big surprise for me. I wasn't expecting it to be, I was expecting the workflow to be a lot more just, you know, full of little headaches, and then the quality to be not as big of an increase. I wasn't expecting this like massive jump. So very interesting. All of a sudden the Z6 becomes one of the most unique cameras out there. So yeah, I don't know. If you guys are interested, I would recommend checking it out for yourself. But first, as always, try it out, test it out, and see if it works for you, because that's really the only way to know. Don't take my word for it. Don't spend thousands of dollars just because I said that this is a really high quality image. First, figure out if it works for you. So that was interesting. I betcha any money, almost all of the camera companies are all of a sudden now gonna be adding RAW capabilities to their cameras. And I betcha in a few years, we're just gonna call it normal video. It's not gonna be called RAW video, because everything, including your iPhone, is gonna be shooting RAW video, ProRes RAW video. It's gonna be everywhere. But yeah, I'm really, really curious to see where this goes, how fast it develops, and also surprised that it was Nikon. Out of all the companies, Nikon, that's putting this much effort into their video. Well done, guys, well done. I very much appreciate the innovation.